And we're going to be going through different points of it. Today we'll actually be talking, I think it's kind of right there, yeah, why Jesus is the only way. So today we'll be talking about the exclusivity of Jesus. The idea that when Jesus says something like, I am the way, the truth, and the light, and he says those definitive statements, that he means that definitively. Where he's, when he says, I am the way, he is the only way. So we'll be discussing that today. Because one thing that's brought up, and this is before progressive or liberal Christianity, but it's been brought up for a long time, you know, I think you guys probably heard it before, where you might be talking to somebody about Jesus, or you might be talking to somebody about the Bible, or church, or whatever, kind of thing, friend, or anybody, or whatever. And they go, well, yeah, you know, all religions are kind of the same, right? You know, kind of thing. I mean, it doesn't really matter. Just all religions are just trying to teach you how to be a good person, right? Or all religions are, you know, are just different paths to the same goal, which would be God or Nirvana or whatever, eternal life, you know, kind of thing. We're going to be talking about just that idea. Now, Monica was the one that really, really wanted to do this idea of progressive Christianity, and actually she and Micah will be speaking in 2 weeks from now, I believe, on their topic. So they'll be sharing that. Today we have our special guest speaker, the founder, the founder prior of G Ministries, Guillermo, not Emma.
Hey.
Well, you're not G Ministries, sorry. But we're gonna have the founder of G Ministries gonna be speaking. He decided to come in. He's free of charge, which is really nice. The only thing is like the only thing he asked was just if we put a merch table. So if you guys want, you can actually buy any of the shirts or books back over there. And to those of you that look, made you look. Guillermo's gonna be speaking. But I wanted to put out one thing, because like I said, Monica really wanted to do this, because if you're somebody who, you know, is like, I want to know more. Oh, there she is. We're talking all about you. Nothing good, I promise you.
All good.
I was just sharing, Monica, that we're going to be talking about these ideas about progressive Christianity. And I said, well, you know, Monica really wanted to talk about this and really wanted to have, you know, some classes where we talk about these kind of things. And not to say that she was the only one. I really wanted to do it also, but she was vocal about it. And I just were like pushing myself to, like, we should start doing this kind of thing. And I said, okay, get off the back. Because if you're somebody that's like, you know, I believe in the Bible and I'm a Christian, but I want to know more about what I believe, right? Which is great. So, you know, Christian class, while it's great and amazing, and I learned so much more from it than I ever think I could, only happens, you know, just for about an hour on Sundays. And Micah's class, you know, which is the second best class, I'm not kidding, it's the best class in Escondido. This is the best class in San Marcos. But North County class, I think, yes. No, just kidding. You go, well, you know, I could only learn so much from a Thursday night class and from a Sunday morning class and from Sunday morning, you know, preaching and stuff. So you do what is the common sense and the very good thing to do, which is, I'm going to go and find more resources. Great. So you go online, you go into the Google machine or you go into the YouTube machine and you start, you know, trying to figure out things. Or you might see posts on social media and you start reading into it. And the problem is, though, is that there's this there's a lot of progressive Christian ideas out there. And while they sound really good, actually, and they sound very inclusive, actually, and very loving at first, you know, kind of, without a close, sharp eye, that's actually different than what we read about in the Bible. It's a different gospel than Jesus ever preaches or is even about. And it's very contradictory to what we're saying is traditional Christianity, very dangerous also. Very dangerous for the soul, because you're getting fed wrong information. But anyways, we're going to be addressing this stuff. And I remember, this is very interesting, I'll give 2 examples where I was like, we really need to start talking about this kind of stuff. Because I was watching a video a while ago, and it was 2 people debating, and there was a Christian debating, and there's another guy. And the other guy goes, well, you know, and they're talking about the same-sex and stuff. And I'm not even going to talk about that. I'm just going to talk about what it's just some things that I thought about. And they're, and so there's the Christian guy, that's another guy, and the other guy is the son. Like, well, you know, that's, you know, what you're saying is good and all, but, you know, from what I understand of the God character, you know, it's like talking about what we see in the God character in Genesis chapter 3, and I mean, this is what these ancient people believe, you know, those stuff. And he's going on and on and on. I keep on hearing him talk about the God character, talking about, well, this is what the people thought in ancient times, you know, and stuff like that. And what we call that, that's called a low view of scripture. The idea that, you know, well, they're just characters. God is just a character, not a real thing. The people, they just wrote what they knew at the time, you know, kind of thing, but they didn't have, like, a, you know, as we believe, a were truly inspired by God kind of thing. And so the reason why I'm pointing this out is because I say, I'm kind of leaving a little bit of information out. Because it was a Christian, and it wasn't an atheist he was arguing with. It was someone who says he's a Christian pastor, with a very, very, very low view of God. And wow, this guy says he claims he's a progressive Christian pastor, and he's a Christian pastor, but doesn't have a high view of God. And, you know, when he just calls it the God character, he doesn't say it's God. Very low view in scripture. And another kind of thing that is also observing. Was I was listening to a interview with a man who is claims to be a Bible scholar, and you know he was putting out these arguments, and I've heard these arguments many times before because you guys know I have used to be in a very strong atheist background for myself, and you know if you ever hear me talking about any aspect about the Bible or anything, oh man, this is like any aspect about the Bible, I start talking. And you guys might notice that it appears that I know a lot of certain topics, you know, kind of thing. And that's just because I read a lot and I study a lot. Whatever I study now, that's pretty much the same amount I used to study at the atheist topic. So I'm very well versed into this kind of stuff. And so this guy's putting out this topic that I'm very, very familiar with because I heard it before and I was, you know, used to think about it also a lot. And he goes, well, you know, here's the thing though, is that a lot of the miracles that we see Jesus doing aren't actual miracles in the terms of what we would think are miracles. And you go, okay, what do you mean by that? And he goes, well, all right, here's the thing. For example, remember when Jesus fed the thousands of people, the fish and the loaves of bread? And he goes, that wasn't an actual miracle in terms of supernatural miracles. Okay, what do you mean by that? He says, well, it was a miracle in terms of human compassion. It was a miracle of human compassion. What do you mean? And he goes, because what actually happened is, you know, Jesus goes and he says, well, to the disciples, how much bread do we have? We only have this much, not enough to feed these thousands. And everyone's looking around hungry and stuff because there's not enough food for everybody. The disciples only have so little fish and so little pieces of bread. And then a boy comes out and he goes, Jesus, I would like to share my food with everyone. And he only has a fish and he has a piece of bread himself. And people see the little boy and they go, wow, this little boy is willing to share. I'm also willing to share. The idea actually was that everybody had food, but no one was willing to share the food. And that's what the miracle was that Jesus brought out the human compassion about people. He didn't actually miraculously make these loaves of bread and these fishes. That is the scripture tells us. No, 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 there's this little boy that was involved. Right? And he goes, well, that's really weird because I read the gospel accounts and I don't even hear anything mention this little boy and stuff like that. And this is what this argument is. Well, it's this thing of human compassion. And that's a big thing for liberal Christianity is it really tries to take away the supernatural components, all supernatural components. Whether it be from Jesus, anything from the Old Testament, or anything about God. And you might see where I'm going with this. Surprisingly, I heard this recently, not from an atheist, but once again, from a Christian pastor, also a separate Christian pastor. Once again, someone that labels himself as a progressive Christian pastor. It's very alarming because these men are saying, you know, that I have this information and I'm a shepherd to people, to Christians, and I'm going to give them information about God. But it's not as the Bible describes in any way whatsoever. It's very disrespectful to the Bible, actually. So this is why I feel like it's very important that we have a series of discussions about this. So I'm going to give the floor to the founder of G Ministries, wherever that guy is. Well, I think I see him back over there. All right. So these guys, you're all prepared for this. You're all prepared for this. And I hope that you guys give them the full respect and attention that you guys don't give me, but this guy deserves. So, there we go.
Thanks, Chris.
Yep.
All right, so Y'all don't know me. My name is, what's up there? I'm just kidding. But Guillermo Uriar, also known as Lupi. And I'm going to teach us about why is Jesus the only way? Because obviously that's a question that may come up, like how Chris was touching on a little bit. It's like, well, what about Muhammad? Or what about X, Y, and Z, Buddha? You know, like all these different people. But that's why it's important that we kind of like ground this so that we know what we believe in importantly. So, so to begin.
Go move the mouse up to the top screen.
The mouse.
Alright, so, because you said so.
Good job.
Thanks for coming to that TED Talk.
Very good, dude. Very definitive. Making a bold statement. Thank you.
Alright. But for real. So, throughout history, we hear many arguments and questions trying to disprove Jesus being the only way. One of them being like he was just a man, another being that, oh, or other religions will downplay him like he was just a prophet. And then there's just the flat out people that are like, he never even existed. He was just a fabrication. Like, he was just made up to like control people and to like just enslave people and like their perspective. But as we read the Bible, we see that that's not true, because we see from the Old Testament all the way to the New Testament, the prophecies, we see the whole, how it all aligns together. And we see that Jesus was not just a regular man, he wasn't, or that he was real, and that he was God in flesh. Mm-hmm. So, many may say that all religions serve the same God, and that there are many ways that lead to heaven, but that couldn't be farther from the truth, and that's kind of just disrespectful for the first part, and it's ignorance at the end of the day, because that's like, you're speaking out of context. Because obviously if you tell a Christian, how do you get to heaven? They're gonna be like, oh, okay, well, you put your faith in Jesus, you repent, and boom. But then you see another religion, you'd be like, oh, well, you know, you just gotta be a good person, you know, go be a nice person. Or like, there's some that are flat out like, well, like, just, like, be a monk. Like, don't even associate with people, like, just live in seclusion. So, that's a big point that many people, or that's what a lot of people fall into. I feel like that's like a lot of my coworkers too. Like I'll talk to them, you know, and then they'll be like, oh, well, like, oh, it's like, I just believe in, like, I believe there's a God, but I think that, like, it's the same God. He's like, I feel like everyone serves the same God, but then I'm just there and I'm like, that's a little disrespectful, because like, you're speaking out of context and like, you kind of don't know what you're talking about, but that's where you could like, show them, like, well, like, yes, and or no, because, but let me explain to you why. So, and then again, it's like many religions may downplay Jesus as just being a prophet or a normal human being. But as we read through scripture and make connections between the Old and New Testaments, we read that he was far greater than that. In reality, we find a lot of truth when we study the life of Jesus and the role he played in saving all of humanity. Because we know, like, the Sermon on the Mount, we know, like, or I'll break it down. So, like, the Sermon on the Mount, he says what? Like, if you have anger towards your brother, you're a murderer. He says, love those who do wrong to you. The people that hit you, be like, well, you can hit me again. Like, all these teachings are so contrary to what the world's going to tell you. Because the world, and that's, this is what kind of like separates Christianity from a lot of other religions and Jesus as a teacher, because they'll be like, oh, if someone does dirty to you, like, you're in your right will to just go and do to them as they did to you. But like, we see with Jesus, like, it's so much like stuff where it's like, man, like it's a cost. Like, following him is tough, because you do have to love the people that don't love you. You gotta be nice to the people that aren't nice to you. And so, I think that's a good point to make about Jesus. All right, so I just have like a little Bible verse in the intro of the next couple slides, just to like point out, because there's obviously places where it does kind of like solidify Jesus being the only way. So the first one's the first chapter of the book of John, the first verse, it says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. It's kind of like a mouthful, a little confusing, but pretty much just like before creation, like, Jesus was there. And then it follows up with that verse, which I forgot to include, where it's like, nothing was made that was not made through him. So, and then like, it's like, a lot of the stuff is kind of like refreshing, right? Because through our classes, like with Chris, with Micah, like they do a really good job at like repeating themes and topics so that we remember them. So like, we read from the beginning of scriptures, the story of redemption only found in Jesus, or found only in Jesus. It's like, it only takes 3 chapters. Like, that's, I remember when I first, like, became a Christian, like, and I started going to Chris's classes, I was like, and he was, like, breaking that down, I was like, bro, like, it was, like, mind-blowing, because I'm like, because I read the Bible before, but, like, you read through and you don't make connections, you don't even understand it. So, like, to see, like, dude, we only hit the 3rd verse, and we already see, like, the first, or the 3rd chapter, and, like, we already see, like, prophecy about Jesus and, like, all these things that line up with the whole Bible, because, like I said, it's like, a collection. It doesn't just say, like, at the beginning, be like, this is this, or, like, this is going to happen, but instead it continues with that, and so I think that's, like, just really cool, because from the 3rd chapter, we're already seeing prophecies, but we see many different prophecies from the Psalms of David to the prophetic scrolls of the prophets, like, and that's what I think is like the most, at least like one of the best things for me, like when I like ground my faith, because it's like, whoa, like, because it's hard for people to be like you don't know what you're talking about. But it's like, well, I kind of do, because I can go X, like I can go here and I can go there. I can show you like so many passages to like that line up with like the New Testament or like the Old Testament. And so, yeah. And so we gotta remember that. When sin came into the world, death came as well. So when Adam and Eve, they sinned, they brought death into the world, which made us all pretty much the way we are now. Kind of like bad people, because we're not good people. So there had to be a sacrifice. There had to be a payment for that crime, that offense in a sense. So, because obviously we're sinning and we're breaking God's law, and another thing is, like, a lot of people will be like, well, I'm a good person, I'll go to heaven. That's, like, that's not true, because if we believe in the Christian God, like, that we follow, if we believe in, like, that he's holy and just, how is a holy and just God going to let, like, bad people go into heaven? Because we've all lied, we've all stolen. So, like, at the end of the day, God's like, I'm perfect, I'm blameless, you know, like, you can't come into my house if you're not like me, right? So that's where we needed that payment. And we see from even the 3rd chapter in Genesis, like Adam and Eve sinned, but God gave like the sacrifice. He sacrificed the animal. He made clothes for them out of that. And that's just the reoccurring theme that we saw throughout like the Old Testament until we finally got to Jesus. And that's why the Levitical, or like the early, after the Ten Commandments, all that stuff, like they were given those rules and regulations for like sacrifice, like how to be clean with sin. Like you have to go to a priest. It's like, oh, I messed up. All right, I gotta get an animal that's like a super nice animal that has no defect, it's blameless. All right, I gotta take it to the priest. He has to sacrifice it for me so I can be cleansed of my sin. So it was a process. Like, and even though that process like worked to a certain extent, it wasn't the completed one, it wasn't the final one, because at the end of the day, like, these people could do that, but they're not changing it here. They're still, like, at the end of the day, they're still going to be lost in their sins, because you can only offer so many sacrifices, like, and that's what the Israelites were doing. Like, they would sin, sacrifice after sacrifice, but it got to the point where, like, they were just doing it because it was just it was becoming normal to them. They're like, oh, like, and it's like, are they truly even, like, do they even feel bad about it? Do they even feel a conviction? Like, they just keep, like, it got to the point where God's like, dude, I don't even delight in your offerings anymore. Like, they're detestable to me. And then he also goes on, like, further to say, like, he's like, I desire mercy, not sacrifice. Because that's what the people were turning into. They were turning to people that were just, like, they're rude, they're mean, and they, like, they're so legalistic, and they follow, like, this pattern to a T. But then sometimes at the end of the day, it's just like, dude, like, it's not about these acts that you're doing. It's about your, like, your inside. Like, are you being nice to people? Are you having mercy? Are you, like, or are you just being, like, a hypocrite? So, oh, yeah, I heard that right there. God is a holy and just God. There has to be punishment for sin, as no one will be able to enter heaven and see God unless they were blameless and without sin. The Old Testament way didn't work that well, as it was only a shadow of what was to come. The law made us conscious of sin, and therefore we are without excuse when it comes. When it comes to being guilty of sin. So yeah, the law, the Ten Commandments were pretty much given to us so that we could be like, oh, like, so this is what bad things are. This is what I shouldn't do. But it couldn't save us. It's like, I could have a list of rules, and at the end of the day, I'm like, I'm still going to break them. Because it's impossible for me to keep it. That's, God already knew that. He knew he was going to give this to people, but it was just going to be a reminder to them, like, look, like, you can't keep this. And in the end, like, you're going to need something to redeem you. That's where we get all these words from, like, redeem, you know, redemption, rejuvenate, like, because at the end of the day, it is a process where, because how are you going to give someone the cure if they don't know they have, like, the cancer, you know? So that's what the law is. The law tells us, like, oh, man, you got the sickness, like, it's killing you, like, you're going to die, like, who knows when, but, like, it's killing you. So, like, we need the antidote.
Wait, can I add something to the other one if you want to go back to this? Well, just to like kind of point out with the Jesus as a sacrificial lamb, that John 1:1, if you actually keep reading it, I think this is like the most, this is where it like points to Jesus, where it says, and the word became flesh. Because that's like, that's, you know, it's saying, hey, he is God, and he came in the flesh, and he dwelt among us. And I think that's like it's like the cherry on top. And so I was like, I just wanted to like add that because I know that's like a very important pointing to Jesus as him being God.
Yeah, that's a good point. Thank you. We are open for discussion and questions. So I was just like, but yeah, if you guys have anything, just raise your hand and like, it's not just like a dictatorship. So. There is nothing we can do. Then there's another Bible verse that says salvation is found, or this is in the book of Acts, so this is after, you know, the church is moving, you know, we got Peter, the apostles, like, they're preaching the word, they're going to synagogues, they're just preaching Jesus, and he makes this bold statement, which is something that, like, I feel like it's fundamental for us to, like, remember, so that if someone comes to me and could pose a question, like, oh, like, where does it say in your Bible that, you know, like, Jesus is the only way, or like, you know, how can you be so like narrow-minded? What says this is just one of them, like I said, like there's a bunch of these, but it's like salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to mankind by which we must be saved. So like, man, that's kind of like straightforward, but it's like it's powerful stuff. So it's like there's nothing we can do to earn our way into heaven or the forgiveness of our sins, as some religions would say. So like Catholicism is like, oh, like, if you sin, well, like, oh, go confess your sins to a priest or do the sacraments, like, do good deeds so like you can get back to that grace or like to that being, that good point. But like at the end of the day, that's, like we said, that's worthless. There's nothing we can do to earn our way into heaven because, like I said, we're not good. If I, like, that's like my example right here. So like, supposing a man breaks the law by robbing a bank and shooting the guard. He stands before the judge with all these crimes committed against him. He tells the judge that he's sorry and that he doesn't do these things anymore. And he won't do it again. The judge will say to him, of course you shouldn't be doing these things and you should be sorry. But guess what? I still got your crimes pitted against you. You still shot someone, you still like killed someone, you did all these crimes. It's like, I'm not gonna judge you on the good things that you've done. It's like, oh, I feed the poor, or like I take care of my family. You know, like, it's like, well, good, you should do that. But at the end of the day, you're still guilty. And you have to pay for that crime. Yes?
Yeah, and like where you're going on there, just to build up even more of that. I mean, it's just like what God tells Isaiah, and Isaiah, you know, writes down. Because there's all, like, Kimo, you were saying a little bit earlier about the sacrifices and stuff, you know, and like, you know, there was a point when Israel was getting to a point where they were just doing the sacrifices because they think, oh, I can just do the sacrifices and keep on living this bad lifestyle. And then they also do, oh, you know, we can do good deeds and stuff, you know, kind of think some good deeds and I can continue doing my lifestyle, whatever that is. And then it goes Well, you know, at this point, Isaiah writes down, you know, God says that your good works are not good works to him. They are more like, and we read it says, more like bloody rags to him. They're worthless bloody rags, or to what it would be actually. And the actual version would be closer to your good works, since they're coming from dirty hands. They're not good works to me. They're not of any worth. They're more like used menstrual rags. Because why? Because they're coming from dirty hands. They're coming from bad people, which is us. And I mean, like, I see people are like, oh, that's kind of gross and stuff. But that's how God sees it, you know? We cannot use any of our good works at all, I think, to please God alone. Because they're coming from sinful, bad people. And that's every single one of us. So it's just about that.
That's a really good point. So in the same way, like with this judge, God's the exact same way. Obviously, one day we're all going to stand before God, and he's going to pretty much read the list. Like, oh, like, it says, what, every idle word spoken, like, every, you know, thought you've had in your heart is going to come out. Like, that's really crazy, because it's like, whoa, like, we were so nonchalant about that. It's like, oh, like, you think, like, one thought, and one, you're like, oh, it's whatever. But, like, at the end of the day, like, all of it's going to come. So we're pretty much like this guy. Where before the judge, we're like, whoa, like, I know I did this, but oh, I'm sorry. Like, I won't do it again. But like, oh, but I did this, you know. Oh, I fed the poor, you know. Like, I took care of, like, my family, the elderly. Like, you know, like, oh, I'm a really good person. You know, I was never mean to anybody. But then God's gonna be like, whoa. But yeah, you did. You murdered. You know, you had hate for your brother or sister. You know, you were lost in, like, sexual immorality or, like, anything. Like, at the end of the day, like you said, God is holy and just. If he wasn't, then obviously, like, then everyone would go to heaven. We could just be like, oh, okay, like, do whatever you want. But no, at the end of the day, like, sin will not enter heaven pretty much. So we're just, like, the lawbreaker. And that's why that's why Jesus is the only way, because he pays that price. He's the atoning sacrifice for our sins. So for this guy, let's say he's like, oh, well, you got all these tickets, you have all these crimes committed against you, but someone paid them off. Does that make sense, right? Like, whoa, like, if someone's paying it out, then you're free to go. That's literally the gospel. That's literally Jesus right there, because we deserve death, and he came, paid the price on the cross so that we may live and have the righteousness of God, mm-hmm. so that one day when we do go up to heaven, we won't be seen as, like, the lawbreakers. We won't be seen like this guy who's like, oh, I'm a good person, but I've done all these things. Instead, we'll be like, well, you did, but he paid the price, and now you get God's righteousness that we don't deserve. Mm-hmm.
No, and I was going to add to that story, and because, like, we can look at it as, like, oh, you know, like, I commit a crime, go to court, and someone pays for it, right? Sounds like a great gift, but it's even better when you can't pay for it. Mm-hmm. Like, it's, like, that much better because you're like, oh, I don't have money to pay for this, and I deserve to go to jail or whatever it is, but here is someone who is gonna pay for it because I can't pay for it. It's not just like I could pay for it and they're just being nice and like giving me that gift. No, it's like I truly can't pay for it. And that's where it's like, that's where you're like, oh, that is a true gift. That's something that I can't earn. I mean, no matter what I do, it's not there available for me to pay for. But Jesus comes, and because he's sinless, he can pay for it.
It's like the love of God that will make us want to obey and mm-hmm. want us to follow it, you know? Because, like, obviously he's paying a great price for us. Mm-hmm. And, like, the least we can do is be like, oh, man, like he said, it's like Jesus said, it's like, if you love me, then you'll keep my commands.
Yeah.
The world will know you're my disciples by the way you love one another. So, like, pretty much, yeah, like, at the end of the day, like, you need faith. But out of your love, like, you'll be obedient.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, in a way, like, you're not doing it to repay him, to be like, all right, God, you did this for me, so I'm going to do that. But instead you're doing it because, like, whoa, you did this for me? But, like, well, now I want to do this for you. All right, so the solution. And there's another Bible verse to hopefully meditate on and remember, because from 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21, says, God made him who knew no sin to be sin for us. So, like, I was just kind of, like, pointing out. So that in him we might become the righteousness of God. It's says, throughout the Bible, we see many passages like this that affirm the sacrifice of Christ and give us hope. All we need to do is believe and have faith to receive this free gift, a gift that we don't deserve, but in God's great love, gave to us. Because that's another thing, like many religions would be like, well, you gotta work for this, bro. So you wanna see God's approval? Like you wanna, when you get to heaven, you want him to like reward you, you gotta do X, Y, and Z. But it's like, no, like all you need is to believe and have faith to receive this free gift. And then from that, once you receive that gift, then that's the process of repentance comes. Like, okay, God, like that's the first step. Now work on me. Now let me work, or like I'll work with you, you work with me. And it's like, it's a molding process to be more like Christ. And there's another Bible verse. Whoa. There's two. Alright, so this is also from John chapter 3, verse 18. It says, whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already because they have not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. Like I said, there's a lot of this stuff. Like, I'm pointing out only a couple verses, but like you read this whole chapter and it's just reoccurring themes of that. You read through the whole New Testament, reoccurring themes of that. This, so many of the themes are faith, repentance, believe, you know, like deny yourself and like proving the validity of Christ. Jesus is the one who makes us clean and grants us everlasting life through his sacrifice on the cross. Alright, conclusion. Like I said, we're all sinners and lawbreakers who have broken God's law and deserve hell. God in his great love sent down his one and only Son so that whoever, it's anybody, doesn't matter what race you are or like what you've done or like who you are, will not perish but have eternal life. That's John 3:16, I forgot about that. But yeah, so like in conclusion, I mean, I don't really know what else to say except that like at the end of the day, like you just gotta read it for yourself and learn it for yourself, because it's hard to just be like, tell, like, don't listen to just me, like go and learn it on your own. Because at the end of the day, I'm just trying to like give you guys pointers and also just give you guys like advice, because at the end of the day, like people are gonna tell us, why do you believe so much? Or like, do you even know what you believe? It's like, well, yeah, because X, Y, and Z. I think the biggest one that just proves like why Jesus is the only way is just because the system of it, like just how it flows. Like, we deserve hell, we're lawbreakers, no one's good, but we need that atoning sacrifice. We need that one thing to like make us right in God's eyes. So we can, like, it all makes sense when you really look at it from when you try to understand it, like it'll make sense to you, because it's like, it is a process. Mm-hmm. And like, another thing is like, why would so many people die for this, you know? Like, we see the apostles, like before, when they were still with Jesus, like they were cowards, there were people that were like, oh man, like a little faith. But like after they saw the truth, the way, the truth, and the life resurrected, and with them, they're like, oh man, like this is too real to me to just ignore. Now I gotta follow with it. It's like, and that still happens till this day. That's why like our calendars, like we're in the year, what, 2021, like someone had such a great impact that they changed the course of history. The man who split time. Like, and like even to this day, like look at the church, like this thing's worldwide. It hasn't slowed down. It started off small and it kept growing, growing, growing. Obviously it's not perfect, but for like people still to be living like Christ and following his teachings and being like him, that's gotta mean something, you know? Because like I said, these people are loving their neighbors. They're loving the people that hate them. The people that like do wrong to them, they do good to them. So it's like, and like even to this day, like people are still like dying for this. Like they're not dying like I'm fighting you with my own sword and I'm trying to take you out. It's like, no, they're like, I believe in this and I want to share this with you. But in return, like the world doesn't understand that. So they'll be like, well, you're wrong and I'm going to torture you for it. I'm gonna fire you from your job. I'm gonna do bad things to you, like so many bad things. So it's like, why? For just one person? Because there's obviously something there. It's the love of God that makes you do those things. So I guess that's it. That's all I got.
I think another thing I was thinking is just that I'm a good person, I do good. Well, we don't believe in Jesus, and we don't believe in, then what are we basing that off of, right? You know, then what you think is right and what you think is right is, or wrong, is very subjective. And so I don't know if that's...
No, yeah, that makes perfect sense, because that's like a huge atheist argument.
Yeah.
Is they'll be like, or they'll ask like, well, where do we get our moral law from? If we don't get it from God, then we get it from ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
Like you said, that's subjective, because I might be like, oh, I don't think it's bad to like slap someone and like be abusive to people, but someone else might be like, well, that's wrong to me. And then that's where that whole like this division is.
Well, and why would we even feel bad about something if there's no right or wrong? You
exactly.
know, if that's not, you know, if we're not following this, then how can I say doing, I don't know, killing, murdering, you know, because maybe it doesn't matter to me, or what's the point? You know?
Well, yeah, exactly. Because at the end of the day, like, God has written those, that law in our hearts. So we know it's like deep down inside, whether you're a liar when you say this, but it's like we do feel bad when we lie. We do feel bad when we steal. We do feel bad when we do certain things, because at the end of the day, like, God's put that inside of us. So like to say that there is no God, then you're saying that there is no law and that there is no right or wrong. So yeah, it's a really good point. I always like touching on that one.
No, and I was going to say, and to add to that, I think, I don't remember where I heard this, but it's like,
it's
with that,
in the Bible?
No, this is like someone talking about what's
in
the Bible. It was like a speaker, but like that, if this isn't true, right, if God isn't real, then, and there's no moral law, then in reality, we're just atoms, and we can be cut off just like a branch, you know? And it wouldn't matter, because a branch is made out of atoms and we're made out of atoms. And so it's like, what would be the difference if there isn't a God who created us with a purpose? We'd just be like a branch who could be, you know, tossed around like nothing, you know? It has no feelings, it'd just be gone just like that.
Yeah, I feel like that's like such a hopeless existence for me. That's how I look at it. Like, if there was nothing in the end, like, man, you'd just be like, what's it all worth then? Like, what's the point of me? Like a lot of people say, like, I built this wealth. I'm storing it up in a barn, like, but in the end I'm just gonna die and it's just gonna go to someone else who's just gonna disappear. It's like, that's where it's like, man, at least that's definitely something for me where like I can be like I have hope. I'm like, I know that when I die it's just not gonna be over and like a waste of time. Like, no, it's like there's something after that which is gonna be worth like everything, or it's gonna be the best thing ever. So.
Well, I mean, to get on to that point that you guys are both talking about, this all three of you are talking about, because in reality, that's what it comes down to. Because that's like one of the biggest. We got a whole bunch, but that's one of the biggest, you know, pegs that we really got in here, and proving Christianity and the Bible's existence and God's existence. You know, because Monica, you were saying all that, it's just all like, okay, well, where do we get our terms for what's right and wrong? And as a Christian, we can say, I get that from God. Yeah. Or the other alternative, and this is the logical alternative, is there is no right and wrong. Because what Monica was just saying, and you know what you're all saying is, well, if God isn't given to us, then nothing gave it to us, because my right and wrong only comes from me. Because who am I to say, you know, that my right and wrong should be the right one compared to another person? And what's the difference for me and this other person other than that? Nothing. We're both human beings. So the person who says, well, it's right for me to be a child molester, I can't say that's right, and I can't say that's wrong, because he's just not a human being, right? And that's the logical reality for it. And then what you were talking about with the whole idea of cutting off the tree branch, because it's just a tree branch, you know, kind of thing. The same. It's just made of atoms, in the same way that another human being is just made of atoms also. I mean, that's the same. I took the, and that's the most logical. And I explain this to my close friends, because I don't explain this to this group of, you know, people that I meet, because it's pretty dark. But you know, that's the most logical kind of thing when you start to come over into this, because you go, well, there is God or there is no God. And if there is no God, then you know, you have to go into the idea of maybe the Big Bang or something like that thing. And or an evolution or whatever, you know, so you start going from there kind of thing. And if you start to believe in that kind of stuff, and you start to believe that there's no creator with no intent, with no design for us, you know, then, yeah, I'm no different than the animal, and the animal's no different than me. And my right, my wrong, it's all the same value as someone else's right and someone else's wrong. And so I say the most logical way to go through that, and I did it myself, man, is either two things from there. It's either become a nihilist or to become an existentialist. And I went the existential route. That's why, to be real, I had went from like 16 to, by the time I was a Christian, so 3.5 years ago, I think I already had like 10 very, very like devastating like suicide attempts, man, because like I'm just taking it to a logical extreme. There's no reason for me to exist, is there? And then, the nihilist approach, which is the approach that David Wood took, which is if there's no reason for me to exist, and there's also no other reason for other people to exist, then it's not wrong for me to take a hammer and bash it into people's heads, is it? And logically, he's right. And logically, I was right also. If there's no point for our existence if we're just random, if there's no point, if there's no morality. But of course, we have a standard. And we find that standard through God's word. Because this other point, and it sounds very drastic, and it sounds very radical, but that's logical, if there's no God. Mm-hmm. If we don't agree that it's logical, or if an atheist doesn't agree it's logical, that atheist, that person doesn't believe in God, is lying to themselves based off of their own belief system. That's the truth right there. Mm-hmm. We have so much hope, man.
Yeah.
People could be I get my moral standard from society, or I get it from the government. It's like that always changes too.
Yeah,
at the end of the day, that still argument comes up.
Yeah.
The same argument comes up. It's like, well, that's your morality. That's not mine.
Mm-hmm. And like that just reminds us, like right now we live in a world where everyone's truth is their own, and that's where we start realizing that we're living the right way because there is only one truth. There isn't thousands of truth. That wall is white, or let's say the wall is blue. That little line is blue because you could say beige. But let's say that line is blue. I mean, Vivian could be like, no, it's purple. And it's like, no, it's blue. It's like, it's not her truth, my truth. It's the truth.
Yes.
And I think that that's really important because we do live in a world where they're going to be like, well, that's true to you, not to me. But it's like, no, there is a truth.
Mm-hmm.
And just because you want to believe that it's not, doesn't mean that it's not. It's still blue, or whatever. Whatever else, it's about God. There is a God. You may not want to believe it, but that doesn't mean that there isn't a God.
Yeah, that would be postmodernism, and that's something that if you guys aren't familiar with, but when I start to explain it, I've been noticing that in the news, I've been noticing that in the spoken. There is such a thing as objective truth, because that is what truth is. Objective truth is it's true no matter what someone else thinks, right? Subjective truth is what's being pushed out more, which is it's true based on the individual's opinion. And we have to establish these terms when we're in all aspects of our life, but especially when we're talking to people, evangelizing to them, that there is an objective truth. And truth is not subjective. It's not, well, I see it this way, you see it that way, and that's our truths. No, that's not how it works. That's not how reality works. And, all of human history has always agreed for that up until within the past, I would say, 120 years. 140. But, yeah.
There is no absolute truth. But you can't even believe that because that's not true.
Yeah.
That's an absolute, too.
Yeah.
Right. People will go, well, there is no such thing as an absolute truth. Are you absolutely true about that? Is that absolutely correct?
Alright, so I guess I'll just close this with prayer and then
I'll share something.
Okay, then there's snack. So we'll eat cupcakes. Alright, dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we just want to thank you for this evening, or for this day actually, for just a little hot blood, just thankful to gather and just learn, Lord, and just thankful that your spirit is with us and that it's constantly just working in us and growing us, Lord. And that at the end, we just have faith, Lord, hope is the biggest one, just as Christians share, a life without morality or God or truth is, it's worthless. There's nothing to live for, Lord, and I can totally relate to that pain of just not having anything to live for and just not finding a way out, Lord, but in your great love, Lord, at the end of the day, you have a plan for us, and you have your plan. You make yourself known to us when we need it the most, and if we just lean on you, Lord, we know that you will just strengthen us. us and lead us and continue growing us, Lord, especially during these trying times, as we see the world just getting more and more just selfish and prideful, just believing in their own truth and just neglecting you, Lord. So we just pray, Lord, that, you know, we just may continue, that your word and that your truth just may continue shining, and that we may continue to be witnesses to that, and just pray for our brothers and sisters in Christ to be lifted up, encouraged, and strengthened, and that nothing may come against us, Lord. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.